Alright, this is a 37 inch Philips flat screen plasma TV that I got for free today from a guy I know, and this is one of those really early upmarket models. It's from 2003, so it's not the most modern thing. Got a 1024 by 1024 pixel panel in it with rectangle pixels, and yeah, I figured I'd give this TV to my mom since she's still rocking an old CRT, but I've got no idea with what's wrong with this TV, if any, so just figured we'd try and turn it on. I just brought it in after coming home today. Oh, yeah. Standby. Got a relay. It doesn't sound too happy. Definitely doesn't sound too happy. Now, I've heard that these have a problem with a few caps, so I'm hoping that's just that. At least it's doing something, so it's probably not had a thunderstrike in it or anything, which is good since we recently had a big thunderstorm, which brought a lot of things down on their knees. Anyway, I've got to get this thing up on my bench and try and get it apart. Thankfully there's a full service manual available for it, which is a good thing since these early LCD TVs don't usually come apart as easily as the more modern ones, like this Samsung that's just sitting around over here. We just have these screws around the back. This one's got a million of them in different places. So we'll see if I can get into it with any luck. If I can get it up on my bench, since I think this thing is, the manual says it weighs 30 kilos. Which is quite a bit for a 37 inch TV. I think this is a 46 inch and it weighs a bit half that, quite a few years earlier as well. This is not mine though, it's just here for attempted repairs. Anyway, this one's first in line, so let's try and get to move on. To get a sense of how old this TV is, the remote has got a dedicated VCR LED. Alright, got it up on the bench and all these screws for only the small back cover off of it. So let's crack it open and see what we find. Oh god, well, it's obvious where all the weight in this TV is coming from. Ugh, this is not aluminium, this is iron. Ugh. Stand is nice cast aluminium though, very solid. It's even adjustable height. You've got two or three positions on these. You don't see that nowadays. Anyway, lots of goodies. Definitely a lot more on this TV than in more modern sets, where it's just pretty much in the modern plasma. You have empty space, power supply about that size, wire sustained there, X system there, a couple of buffers, usually a T-con kind of deal down there, and that's it. A little main board with a few HDMIs, then you're done. This is quite a bit more fun. Love old early technology, pioneering stuff, lots of big caps. Philips tend to use quality caps though. So really, unless there's something wrong with the caps, or if the TV is just run its hours, they don't tend to get bad caps. But yeah, someone I spoke to told me a lot about small surface mount caps, and I can see a fair few of them in the power supply and just scattered all over, so could be worth checking a few of those out. Probably end up replacing them with non-surface mount caps because I can't be bothered to order surface mount ones. Here you can see these stupid input connectors with RC out, whatever that is. This thing just has two VGA inputs, and there's this external box that does all the processing. Got it back here. These boxes tend to break as well, get some strange issues. Seen a few broken ones, but this thing is the size of a home theater receiver. You've got a big Pioneer 6950 down there to compare with, so it's not a small thing. Definitely takes up a spot on its AV rack, but it's not half bad looking. I think this is just a green, red LED, no blue ones. Buttons even made out of metal. This is aluminium. Just thin aluminium on plastic, but still aluminium. Could do a whole lot worse. So yeah, I'm going to take a crack at just looking and measuring around this thing. Try and figure out what's wrong with it. This is definitely plastic. This is plastic as well. Seems weird gold grainy colored kind of plastic. Probably got some metal particles inside of it to improve shielding. I think this might be the audio amp. These TVs have rather great speakers, and I think they are even bi-amplified. The service manual said something about that, which, by the way, is fantastic. Just look at all these disassembly instructions. Just page after page. This manual's 170 pages long. You could just dream about finding that for a modern TV. Don't think they've made proper service manuals for at least 5 years, sadly. But I've got something to go on. Alright, so I've spent some time just reading the service manual until it's turned into something more reminiscent of a school book than a service manual for a TV. Very nice. But I decided to just take the power supply out, since I'm reasonably certain the problem isn't there. I've tried disconnecting various modules, and it behaves the same way. And it's making some less than comfortable noises. And I've been poking around with the ESR meter, and I found a couple of caps which look a bit iffy. This 220 microfarad cap had about 170 microfarads and had an impedance of 2-3 ohms. And a few of these little 2.2 microfarad SMD caps have an impedance of about 25-30 ohms, whereas my new pretty bog standard quality so through hole 2.2 microfarads have about 5 ohms, which most caps of this size range should have. So I'm going to try and bodge a few of these in and see if I can find any more troublesome caps. Most other caps, SMDs, measure just as you'd expect them to. They measure about the same as my normal through-hole caps, so I have no reason to assume that these would have any reason to be worse from the factory than any of the others they've used, since they're probably the same series. They all look the same. So I removed the two of the 2.2 microfarad caps, and they measure just as bad out of circuit as they did in circuit. 25 ohms in that one, 29 in this one, and way under less capacitance. And if we compare it to a good 2.2, that's a considerable considerable derating in performance. And if we go by the trick of measuring a identical cap elsewhere on the board, which we thankfully have, we can see that this other cap at a lower position on the board has 10 ohms lower impedance, so, and a lot more capacitance, so that's a surefire sign that these have aged. And, well, 18 ohms isn't good for a 2.2 microfarad cap anyway, so that one's gone too. But the important thing to note is that it measures way better than these two did.
So I'm probably going to just replace all the 2.2 microfarad caps on this board right away. There should be maybe 5-10 of them, they're about, I can see them scattered all over. Quite a few surface mount caps on this one, surprisingly. You don't usually see surface mount caps on power supplies and TVs, but all in all, this is a very high quality power supply, I must say. The documentation is fantastic. Really, thumbs up to Philips for actually taking some time of making a good power supply in the TV, although it's an aging TV and it was all the rage back then. It probably cost quite a few $1,000s back when it was new. Alright, I've replaced every electrolytic cap in the power supply, which measured kinda wonky. It's 4 2.2s and 1 4.7 microfarad SMD and yeah, a couple of big ones. These two I replaced just off the suggestion of Google without even measuring them, but they seemed fine. 100 microfarad, 50 volts, and yeah, this one was one we measured bad, 220-25. Anyway, it's plugged in, so if it doesn't fire now, it's very unlikely that it's a capacitor in the power supply. It could still be the power supply in itself, some semiconductor or other wonky problem, but it's definitely not going to be a cap. So, let's see. Doesn't sound happy. Nope. Bit of a shame, although those caps needed to be replaced anyway. One possibility ruled out. Well over 1,000 left to go. Okay, so after spending about 15 hours across 3 days on this TV, I decided to do a kind of novel thing in troubleshooting these plasma TVs, which I kind of don't usually recommend doing, but after spending so much time on this device, I decided it was worth a risk. So what I did was I took my lab power supply, set it to roughly the rail voltage of various power rails on this TV, and essentially with a very low current limit just started charging up the caps on the rails, and this is in order to check whether or not there's something that kind of breaks down at a higher voltage which you can't detect with your ohm meter or diode tester. And indeed, I managed to make one of the power rails short out, and that was due to this little transistor. I believe it's number 7052 on the board, some small signal device. This is, well, small signal, it's an 18 amp MOSFET, but it's purpose is to discharge the rails evenly, so that when one of these caps, the rail voltage starts dropping after you turn it off, it shorts out the other one, so you don't get a unbalanced charge in the caps. There's probably some good reason for it, to reduce wear on the actual plasma driver boards. Anyway, I replaced it with just some random main switcher there, which fit enough of the specs, and I just did a very quick power-up test, and it does not go into the tick mode as it did before, but on that test I thankfully didn't have these signal cables to the X and Y sustain boards hooked up, so it didn't give any picture, but it sat there doing nothing, so, and it didn't give the red blinking LED, so this could be it. Got my power cord hooked up to my power meter. It used about 24 watts before. Hey. It did something. Went to standby. That's a whole lot more than it's done before. But still no cigar. But we did get a little flash of noise on the plasma, which is a definite step up. And it just occurred to me that I had this diagnostic jumper installed to get the TV into a
mode where it just blinks out code on the front LED. And check this out, have a listen. That sounds to me like plasma driver circuitry doing what it's supposed to do. And shut off again, probably for no signal. Well, that is a definite step up. That is a living panel. Definitely a living panel. Sweet! I just hooked up my laptop and that is definitely picture. Sweet! It seems to have a bit of a buzzing coming out of the speakers though. So I might have to look into that. I don't think it's supposed to be that way. Could be volume's just turned off way high though. But that is sweet. I've put so many hours on this thing. And I did suspect it was that one transistor, and I measured it and it measured fine. But apparently, that wasn't the case. You live and you learn. I actually measured the transistor properly. I hooked up a power supply to the gate, and I used a multimeter to just measure how much it conducted for a certain gate voltage. I would never have expected that to be bad, so thank goodness it broke when I did the voltage test. Not the most efficient beast, this thing. 300 watts for a 37-inch TV. Not that impressive. Alright, so it's facing up again. Got everything hooked up for a first test run. Lights nicely dimmed for the ambience, so let's see what happens. Also got some anime loaded on the laptop just to see what it looks like. That's the analog tune, and wow, this thing this thing looked bad. Oh wow, I hope that's the analog tune making that noise. Well, that's the VGA input. Looks a bit less noisy, but let's just get a dark image up there. No idea what the resolution it's running at is. Yeah. Definitely not a great performer. But it's got a picture. Looks very blue on the camera since we've got a very warm light in here. But yeah. Dark shades rarely don't look good on this TV, definitely not. There aren't really any adjustments you can make either to it. So, that's a bit of a shame. It's really, I wasn't expecting great performance out of this, but this is really subpar. You can just see all the pixel noise all over. I hope that showing up on camera this thing is not refreshing unnecessarily fast. We do have sound. On one channel. These things do have great speakers. All that well, it's essentially just a speaker enclosure on each side of the TV. Well, at least it works. If it's too bad for Mum, well, I can at least sell it for $100 or so. Well, just to bypass the box that came with the TV, and that immediately made the picture about 100 times better, and it gave a stereo sound as well, despite all connections being properly made in both ends. So yeah, no more collar banding, at least not anywhere nearly as bad. Yeah, still not perfect, but a lot better. So I guess I've got to take this thing apart. It didn't seem to be doing too well since the menu system on it kind of didn't work properly. It's supposed to tie into the menu system on this TV and give you, for instance, the bass and treble settings down there, but they were, now without the box, they are just grey and you can't access them, but with the box they are white but you still can't access them. So yeah, something's not right with this guy. I have seen several of them fail. I think they do get bad caps sometimes, but sometimes we also get some rather horrible internal problems that I haven't found the solution for. So fingers crossed for caps in this one. Right, and here's the inside of the box. Right off the bat, it doesn't seem to have any obvious bad caps, but I've got to measure them. Big honking power supply. And these things were really fancy back in the day, since they came with triple analog tuners. I believe they are analog. I would be very surprised if one of them is digital. But yeah, they did picture in picture and all kinds of processing stuff, most of it analog. So they're really funky in that way. Got no idea what this box does. That looks so ancient. This looks more 90s than 2000s technology. Yeah. There's a lot of stuff that can go wrong in one of these. A lot of stuff. Well, you gotta be clever. I ripped into this box, had all this stuff out, measured around. Found out that most of the SMD caps are kind of, not really that great, but they're not out of spec, so it should be alright. 20 ohms in 10 microfarad caps all over. They should be replaced. Anyway, after that I figured, hey, I've only been using the computer input and I can't access the menu on the box while I'm running the computer input, and I can't access the menu while there's no source connected. So I ran off to my GameCube, which is the only SCART enabled source I have. For all you Yanks, the SCART connectors, these big things back here. Wonderful standard. And sure enough, the balance is set fully to the left. And you can't change that from the TV. And back to center, we have both our speakers. It's weird, it's so common for TVs to do this. When you run from a computer input, you can't access half of a bloody menu items, but they still bloody well apply. I don't understand that. Why would they have menu items that you can apply, but you can only set while you're using some analog input, or on HDMI sets when you're not using computer? On my old Samsung 50-inch TV from about 2010, there was at least 5 settings, especially involving audio and HDMI color depth and so forth, well, blackness or whatever that one setting is called, that you could change for any particular input, but you couldn't access it while you're running from a computer. Only while you're running from a Blu-ray player or something like that. It's absolutely stupid. Anyway, now I've just got to figure out how to actually get any picture from this. I might want to hook this picture-in-picture module in again. It could be some other module. Really, this doesn't look like an antenna connector, which could be one of those cheap ones.
Yeah, I once fixed one of these boxes by simply removing this module. Everything worked afterwards that the customer wanted, but something was preventing the box from even booting in this one module, and as you can see, the box runs just fine without it, but for some reason I'm not getting any picture. But that could be because the GameTube's just putting out composite video over SCART and the box might not support it. Or might not support from that input. I should try the front input as well. Okay, inserting the module back made everything work and look great, but now the TV's in Russian! Okay! Anyway, after some more service manual magic, I found myself into the service alignment mode, which is essentially the service menu on these TVs, and this thing has 9,438 hours on it, which for an 11-year-old TV equals just over 2.5 hours per day of use. That's nothing. No wonder it's so fresh. Must belong to somebody who just didn't watch a whole lot of TV, I suppose. I was expecting this to be well over 20,000 hours, given the noise we're getting the panel all over. But, yeah, 9,400 hours, that's not too bad. I mean, most people put that on a TV in just a couple of years. This is pretty much the hour count I see on any TV from 2007 or so that we get into work. So there's more hope for this thing than I initially thought. You could also see the error codes stored in the TV, and pretty much all of these are screaming bad power supply, bad power supply. We also have some settings for the picture, which we don't get for in the normal menu on the TV, so I'm going to run some test patterns and see if I can maybe get it working a bit better. Sadly though, there's not a whole lot of information about these settings in the service manual, so I'm just going to have to try fiddling around and hope I don't break anything. You have to actually save the settings manually though, so I can get it back in case I fuck something up. And it took roughly 5 minutes for me to manage something that could not be reverted very easily. I accidentally ran a ADC alignment, completely ignorant of the fact that it requires a very special picture fed into the monitor in order for the alignment to work properly. And I figured, hey, no big deal, I'll just exit the SAM mode, service alignment mode, and it'll be undone. But nope, sorry, this setting is saved right away. And as you can see, at the moment, this monitor is rather pink. That's supposed to be a HSL palette right there, and pretty much everything except red and blue is gone. So, thankfully, I have the fantastic manual, and it specifies in written word what the ADC alignment picture looks like. So I've now spent about half an hour recreating that in Photoshop manually. So let's see if we can actually fix this TV. I would hope so. If this is the wrong image, I'm not sure what I'm gonna do. Well, it's not pink anymore. Hey, look at that. Ha! Phew! That was a close one. Alright, so I went through the alignment mode and made a few adjustments. Use my colorimeter to improve the color presets after aging the panel for 10,000 hours, and everything is checking out quite alright, but something strange is, after I did all that, I have a whole heap of new menu items on the TV, including all these audio options, which were only available with the box connected. I've just got the TV hooked straight to my laptop right now. And beyond that, I found that Philips had done something absolutely evil and hilarious with the language options on this set, because they have differentiated between English and US English, but the only difference is that with US English you get symbols. So they're basically saying that the Americans need to, well, they have changed the color spelling to color, but they're basically saying that Americans can't read their own language and need little symbols to tell them what they're doing. Really weird that they've done it that way. I can't imagine it being anything but an engineer wanting to have a stab at the Americas. Either way, I'm starting to spend way too much time on this TV. Everything seems to be working perfectly now though. It looks great after I got the alignment fixed, and I think we lost a little bit of color banding when I did the ADC adjustment properly. So yeah, I think I'm gonna start to pack this TV up and see if I can fit it upstairs. So finishing up on this project, here's all the files that came out of the TV. Most of them weren't related to the problem, but lots of these little SMD caps were measuring kind of bad, so if you're trying to fix one of these, I would recommend replacing at least the 2.2 microfarad and the 47 microfarad ones. They seem to be worse than the others. Same really goes for the box. There's a whole heap of 10 microfarad ones in it that seem to be kind of wonky, but I think they're in the VGA pass-through circuit, so not too critical. Anyway, the actual problem was this little transistor, of course, number 7052 in the schematic, and the major sign that that particular transistor was broken was that there's a large grey NPTC on the circuit board on the secondary side, number 3053 in the schematic. It got very hot while the TV was having the ticking noise and not starting up, so if your TV has that problem, check that PTC. If it's getting hot, perhaps your transistor's done too. There were some signs of earlier troubles with that transistor, since they had installed a bodge cap right over it from the factory. This was just soldered onto it from the, I believe it was the source to the drain pins. So they've obviously had issues with that transistor before. Now, you might call me stupid for not putting it back in, but it just couldn't fit with my new larger transistor. And since my new transistor is a whole lot more powerful than the old one, I'm hoping that it'll last. This transistor only works when the TV is in the process of being turned off and it needs to discharge the high voltage rails. So it shouldn't see too much use. The original one is probably just kind of under-dimensioned. But yeah, I suppose that rounds up the project. I'm not going to bore you with installing this TV upstairs, so cheerio. Also, serum in the stuff to the SD card. Good timing. See you next time. Thanks for watching. Before we go though, I just want to demonstrate the pure loudness you can get out of the speakers on this TV. So I'm sitting about a meter and a half in front of it, and I've turned the compression on my camera off, so I'm probably a bit quieter now than I was before, but I'm just going to keep on talking and turn off the volume, and to just give you an idea of how loud this TV goes in comparison to my voice. I'm just talking just about as loudly as I did before. I'm really not changing the level of my voice at all, and I can imagine myself being quite hard to hear over the sound of this TV. You can feel the bass in your chest really if you turned up on a beta song. The frequency response goes down to below 50 Hz, no doubt about it. Shame you don't get speakers like that in new TVs. Cheerio.